afternoon. Yep, Linda's right. I'm not well. I sound fine. I occasionally have an inner ear issue that makes me feel very giddy, and I'm feeling like it now. So some of you probably might appreciate that and been there. It was quite interesting yesterday. I suddenly was putting a book back on a shelf in a library. I'll explain about that later. And as I was putting this book, I suddenly went, oh, grab the shelf. Okay, I'm all right. So occasionally, if you see me do this, it's because I've suddenly gone very, you've all gone a bit funny. Okay. Anyway, it's really good to be here. I was last meant to speak when it snowed heavily. Do you remember that? And this got cancelled. So it's a lot nicer out there today than it was then. So it's quite pleasant to be here. A lot of you don't really know much about me. All you know is my name's Warren. You probably see me here on the odd Wednesday. I'm sort of running from that office out here. I normally am wearing a T-shirt or much, and a very large cup of tea. I'm the one who carries the very large, colourful mug that my daughter painted for me. She actually painted it for me sometime last year. And it's just one of those. I have a 6.5-year-old daughter, and she painted that. Being a proud daddy, you like to carry that around. But that's normally me. And I'm assistant to Pastor David Wise here. I'm his assistant. So my official title is Pastor's Assistant. But that's about it for now, because I'm going to tell you the rest of my life story today. You might be bored, I'm sorry, but I feel that's what we want to do. But I want to read a piece of scripture first from Jeremiah chapter 29 and verse 11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Quite a well-known verse by vast majorities that may have been around church, especially on Sundays. It's one of those that, and it's one of those sort of caption verses that, it's isolated and puts on bits of card and puts on nice posters on pictures. So it's quite a well-known verse. But some of us don't know where it comes from, what it's about. This was in the year 598 BC, so before Jesus has come. It was nearly 600 years before his arrival. And this was the prophet Jeremiah, the Lord speaking through him, to what was by that point the Israelite nation had been very, very naughty to God, and God had then exiled them out of the promised land and sent them off into exile because they'd been naughty. But it was at this point that God was giving them a future hope. He was going to let them know that they would be coming back from exile through his forgiveness and through his grace. And it was to say, I have plans for you. Plans to give you a hope and plans to give you a future. So he wanted them to know that because he wanted to get their attention. The reason he sent them into exile was because he wanted their attention. And he had to do it this way to really get their attention, because they weren't actually obeying God at all. But as gracious as God is, he wasn't just going to leave them abandoned and think hope was over and done with. So through the prophet Jeremiah, one of these many, many, there's lots of verses on it, but that particular key one is to say, I know the plans I have for you to give you a hope and a future. So you will be coming back to the promised land. Now, bringing it forward to today, because we're now in Jesus' time after his death and resurrection, that's the same goes for us. When Adam and Eve sinned, and were cast out of the Garden of Eden, we were separated from God. Humankind were then separated from God. We were exiled as such. But through Jesus, God has given us back a hope and a future. Now, in another version of the Bible, because we always read from the New International Version, in another slight translation, there's the English Standard Version, and the word, there's a word there that they say to give you welfare. Now, actually, in Hebrew, that welfare means shalom. And if you know, shalom means peace. And actually, I'd say that a slightly better translation that God was trying to say to the Israelites, come to give you peace. And that's why Jesus died on that cross. It's to give us peace. Unfortunately, I don't know about you lot, but I tend to not want to listen to God quickly and that often. I tend to reject that peace, or I have done in the past. And God has to get my attention, and has always had to get my attention. So I'm going to give you a bit of my life history. Are you ready for this? Okay. I was born... I told you I'm going right back to the beginning. Okay, I'm only 38. I know I'm young and probably youth-like. But some of you have seen a lot more of life than I have. But I'm 38 now. And I was born in Perivale Maternity Hospital, just up the road. No longer there, I'm afraid. Yeah. I have lived here in this area all my life. I have never moved. So maternity hospital... I am the eldest of two children. My brother he lives in Singapore now, but I'm the eldest of two, and my parents must have smiled as this wonderfully handsome baby appeared. I'll have to check that with my mum and dad. I'm not 100% sure, to be honest. But yep, appeared, maternity hospital, 1970 it was, October the 14th. My parents weren't churchgoers at all. Very loving parents, a very loving family, and I can't deny that for one moment. Took me home, and we lived in Hanwell for the first 15 years of my life. As I said, I've always lived here, so it was all Hanwell, as you meant to say, and it's not Hanwell, you say Hanwell. And for 15 years, and then we moved out here to Greenford. But before we come to that, I'm just going to talk about Hanwell. As I said, my parents weren't churchgoers. So we had never went to church on Sundays. I didn't believe that God existed, to be honest with you. I had a Disney's children's Bible, which was incredibly interesting. It was the Bible, but with all the Disney characters. So, you know, you had like your Mickey Mouse and your Pluto, all sort of dotted through the Bible. It was incredibly interesting. But I never really read it. It was there. I liked the pictures, and that was about as far as it went. Anyway, when I got to... somewhere in my middle school, I went to Gurnell Middle School, and when I got to there, my parents decided I needed to go to some church group that was happening for a few weeks. Turns out it was a boys' brigade meeting. I had no idea at the time. I've only sort of learned that subsequently at South Hanwell Baptist Church, I believe, Baldur's Road in Hanwell, and I went there for a few times, and I ended up being friends with the pastor's son. There. I did not know. I knew he was the son of the guy that was at this church and he was something to do with one of the leaders. So I went there for a few times. And do you know what put me off going there was that one day I was playing with this pastor's son and we was getting a bit bored outside and we said, so we used to do something different. And he said, let's go back to your house and watch TV. And he turned around and said, we don't have TV in our house. We don't believe in having a TV. Now, bearing in mind, I absolutely love TV. I'm one of these. I was at a childhood. I think TV was great. I loved all those programs. I was heavily into Dukes of Hazzard then. And I can't even remember half the programs, but I enjoyed them. And Starsky and Hutch. There you go. There's one. That was one of my things. I even had Starsky's car. I had their... the red car with the white stripe down it. Anyway, I was into TV. So my immediate reaction was, well, if you go to church, it means you can't have a TV. Not having any of that. Nope, not going to church. I'm not going to get to know this God whatsoever. So basically, that sort of eventually terminated my relationship with going to church at that point. God didn't give up on me, though. He still wanted to obviously get my attention. Now, just to give you also that God must have been working in my life even at that time and was aware of the future he had for me. That was because my parents wanted me to start swimming lessons when I was about, I think it was about 8 or 9. And they wanted me to start swimming lessons, so I started going to Gurnell Swimming Pool. Ealing Swimming Baths were then initially open at that time, at the back of the town hall as it was. It's now destroyed and is now a car park. But initially it's Ealing Swimming Baths. Gosh, I've just remembered that. And I was part of the Ealing Swimming Club. I remember getting trained, and I remember how it all happened. Anyway, we then transferred to Gurnell Swimming Pool because Ealing Baths were being shut down. And I still continued, and I continued in that all the way up to the age of about 16, going virtually at least 3 times a week to the club, and on the odd occasion in the odd morning, early in the morning, to get some training. And I enjoyed swimming. I love swimming. To me, being in the water is like being totally at peace, almost. It's that sort of sense I enjoy going up and down. But there you go. Knew nothing else of it. I just thought that was me wanting exercise. Great. I went to Brentside High School. Still didn't believe in God, by the way, at this point. Heavily into my science fiction by now. I was into Star Trek and Star Wars and all those great... The new movie's out, the new Star Trek movie's out, 7th of May. I'm off to the cinema. I'm going to go and watch that, looking forward to that. But I was into sci-fi. I was into movies, reading science fiction books, Knight Rider, you know, you name it, anything, but not into God. God did not exist as far as I was concerned. In high school, when you get to high school, but strangely, religious education classes we had to go through. Religious education classes, I always passed. I always did really well in RE. Though I didn't believe a word of what I was doing, I did really well. Our teacher was the deputy head of Brentside High School. His name was Mr. Liddellow. Main name probably means absolutely nothing to no one here, but didn't really mean anything to me at the time, but I'm very grateful to him. And I wish I could have told him so, to be honest. And he taught us RE. One of the other things that happened at high school in those days, doesn't happen so much now, unfortunately, is that they come in with the Gideon's Bible. Yeah? And you get given it free of charge. You get given this little red New Testament and Psalms Bible. And so we all got given them at some point in our teenage years. I can't quite remember when it was, but we all got given them in the class. I wrote my name in the front. I remember doing that. Put it inside my blazer pocket. Thought, oh, this is nice. I got something new. And it was free. We'll keep that. Great. Anyway, a couple of days later, at the assembly, standing up on the podium, our deputy head, at the end of our assembly, the deputy head, Mr. Liddellow, turns around and says, Warren McNeil, please can you see me after assembly? And he holds up aloft the red, I know this is green, holds up the loft and says, I have your Gideon's Bible, you have dropped it. I had no idea I'd lost it. God knew, God had got it found, and God was going, here is, Warren, I'm trying to get your attention. So I said thank you, and I picked up my little red Bible, and I took hold of it. That was about as far as it went. I never really opened it up. I never got past Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, when I ever read it. But God was obviously still trying to get my attention. Well, I left school at the tender age of 16, 3 O-levels under my belt, English, Maths and History. I didn't want to do RE as an option, even though I was doing well, didn't want to do RE. And I left. And I went into the world of a estate agency. I wanted to sell houses for a living. Because by the time I got to 15, we'd moved to Greenford. And a estate agency had fascinated me. I'd like using my mouth. I'd like to sell. I know estate agents don't have a very good reputation. I was one of the honest ones, really, honestly. So I did that for a few years in the late 80s. I gave up swimming at that point. Work was getting too hard. And I started discovering the delights of spending too many hours in a pub, too much time drinking, and too much time smoking and having a good time, as I saw it at that time. But God still wanted my attention. Still, God had plans. Still, God wanted to give me that peace. My mum started coming to this church when I was 19. By the time I was getting to 21, my mum wanted to get baptised here. And, you know, we've got a baptism pool underneath here. So she invited myself, my father, and my brother and said, I would really like you all to come. And we're like, all right then, we'll come. Okay, Mum, you want us to come. 21 by this point. So I didn't believe in God still. I'd asked my mum a few questions, but I really didn't believe God existed. And to be honest, I thought Christians were a bit weird. If I want to be honest with you, if you went to church, it was a bit weird. But anyway, we came and my mum had this baptism. Now, there was nothing at all that went on in this baptism. There was nothing said and nothing done. Nothing we sung, because I don't even remember what we sung. I don't even remember my mum's testimony. All I do know is my mum got baptised. That particular morning, I realised there was something missing in my life. I have no other way to describe it to you. It was just at that moment, God really then got my attention. He really got my attention. Now, just before I carry on, I just want to ask, as I said to you, God was trying to get the Israelites' attention. God has worked all through our lives, always trying to get our attention. And I had ignored God for 21 years. Maybe you can think of times now where you know that God has been getting your attention all through your life. You can have a memory, you can suddenly go back and see where God has been working in your life, trying to get your attention. Yeah? Yeah. Thing was, I kept ignoring him. I hope none of us here have done that in the process. I hope we're still grabbing his attention and we're going, yes, Lord, you've got my attention. But anyway, he got my attention. About a year into, I kept asking my mum lots of questions. I didn't come to church. I kept asking my mum lots of questions at home. I was still living at home, by the way. I was one of these boys. I weren't going to leave home. It was too easy. I got my meals cooked for me, you know. I had a nice, easy life. It was great. I didn't have to do any real washing up. I just went to work, came home, went down the pub with my mates, and, you know, I'd always get cooked meals, and my washing would be done for me as well, and I just had to help out occasionally, help my dad dig the garden or recreate a new driveway or whatever. But, you know, that was fun. That was enjoyable. So that was okay. Easy life. I won't ask if any of you got sons or daughters that were like that as well. I better not. I wouldn't ask what you thought of us. Anyway, then really one Sunday morning, my life was fairly miserable. It wasn't particularly in a good place. For many years, I'd got myself into debt through socialising. Through lots of things like that. But my life was not at that peace. I was not at peace. So one Sunday morning, I woke up and I said to me, Mum, can I come to church with you this morning? You could have knocked her over with a feather, I think, at that point. Yeah. We brought her round. We woke her up. And we went to church. And that was it, really. I started coming here. Various things happened. People were friendly. For a starter, that was helpful. I was accepted. Andy, Linda's Andy, actually got me involved in the PA. There you go. Got me strapped in. Made sure I was behind this PA desk. I was fascinated with this very large desk. You don't get to see it here on Wednesday mornings, but we have an even bigger desk than it is now then. And I was fascinated. But the people were friendly. And I could see there was something different about them. They had a peace about them. And there was various other issues. Pastor David himself, various bits of teaching, one-to-one, went to a house group that he was running and was able to ask some questions there. And these things just sat with me. Anyway, in my car one day, I invited Jesus into my life and the peace started. Then another following day, one Sunday, I was walking from the back of the church to the back, and Pastor David said to me, "Isn't it about time you got baptised, Warren? How do you know?" Okay, that was a bit... So, yeah, fine. So, January 1993, I got baptised. And I got baptised in that water just as my mum had got baptised. God had well and truly got my attention, and I had turned my attention at long last to him. Absolutely praise the Lord. Unfortunately, I didn't fully turn my attention to him. It's taken a long process. We won't go into it too deeply, but let's put it this way. Some of the old things of the past were still hanging around. But what also did happen in that process of coming to Greenford Baptist Church was there was this lady that was playing the piano at the front. And she smiled. Not at me, she just smiled. And I looked and I thought, that's the woman I'm going to marry. It really is. Something shines out of her face, and that's the woman I'm going to marry. 4 years later, and we're still friends. Because I was too chicken. But we were friends. Her name is Joy. You might occasionally see her. She now works at the preschool at the back. And eventually she had to sort of let me know that she liked me so that I could have the courage to ask her out. And that was it, really. And we got married. I got married in 1998. We then, 4 years later, had a child, Keris. And that was great. And life seemed to be actually improving at that point. My walk with God sort of got improved just after I got married to Joy. Joy was one of those people that needed to come into my life to help me get properly full attention turned towards God. And again, God wanted my full attention. He got my attention in 1992, but he really wanted my attention. By this point, by the way, I failed to explain that I was working for a car rental company by now. And I was progressing, thanks be to God, through the ranks. I had turned into a manager by the time I'd got married, and I was had a company car, got promoted, and things were happening for us. Joy and I moved out to Northolt by this point. We got a flat in Northolt when we got married. So I did move a little bit further out of the area from Hamwell and from Greenford, but we moved to Northolt. We had Keris, as I said. This little bundle of joy called Keris. Keris in Welsh means to love, to be loved. And we had, And we had Keris. And about a year and a half into having Keris, I then gained rheumatoid arthritis. Don't feel sorry for me. That's not the point of the story. I got rheumatoid arthritis. That hurts. Got it from my whole body. What I found from rheumatoid arthritis is the best form of exercise for it is swimming. And as I said earlier, God must have been working in my life. Because all those years of swimming lessons, all those years where I could swim quite naturally, God foreknew possibly what was going to happen. God knew that something was coming and he had made sure I was trained to swim. So swimming for me was natural. So quite easily went back to swimming. Anyway, thanks be to prayer, the medical services, etc. It nowhere near hurts as much as it could do. And lots of swimming also does keep me very fit and very well. And Gurnell and me are friends again. And I swim there most mornings. God fully got my attention. And as I sat one day and reflected back over the years, I realised how much God had been working in my life to give me that peace. And the same must go for each and every one of us here. Difference is, I had to give him my attention. giving my full attention, as the Israelites did. They had to seek his face with all their heart for them to be returned back to the promised land. And that's what they needed to do. Anyway, I no longer work at that cart rental company. God clearly got my attention last year when he told me in a meeting that I was to leave my job and come here to be David's assistant. So I did, back in September, quit my job. I now study 2 days of the week at London School of Theology, hence the whole story of me putting a book in the library and suddenly having to grab hold because of my giddiness yesterday. But I study there. I found out yesterday also that I passed 2 of my essays, which I'm really over the moon at. I thought I'd failed one of them, but I hadn't done really well. God has been getting my attention. And the other Sunday and the other 3 days of the normal working week, I'm here. God's got my attention. Doesn't let us down. And just my last parting words is, thank you for hearing my story. And I'm sure you all have a story of your own about how God has intervened at various points in your life, getting our attention, changing things, working in us. All he asks so that we get that peace is that we give him our full attention back and say, yes, Lord, you've got my attention. Here is my life. Do with it as you will. Thank you for listening to me.